I start doing the nearest neighbor interactions. So I consider again a lattice, and I will tell you where I make the mean field approximation. To a great extent, you will see the things will be done exactly. To a great thing, it will be done exactly. Then at some level, you will see a very intuitive approximation will be made. Okay. So in order to get start, let us see the following things. Since we are talking of nearest neighbor interactions, I have the following variables. So at a given configuration, I have, so if I want to write the Hamiltonian, so let me write the Hamiltonian again H as minus J I j nearest neighbors, then I have minus B sigma I. Now look at this, so what does this term depends on? Since the nearest neighbors, it depends on whether my spins are, how many of my spins are parallel, how many of my spins are anti-parallel. So now I introduce the following things: number of spins which are up and down is here. So I have number of spins up, one variable n plus. I have one number of spins down, one variable n minus. I have number of nearest neighbors which are up, because that comes naturally here, n plus plus. Then I have number of spins which are down, parallel. Then I have which are plus and minus, one parallel, one anti-parallel. That means in this Hamiltonian, I have 5 variables. These can be expressed in terms of 5, these 5 numbers. So, however, one thing we need to now know that, and this is something you should ponder about, that in there is a relation between n plus and n minus. That means n plus plus n minus equal to n, right. So there is one condition. So I do not have all 5 independent variables. I have right now 4 independent variables. Then there is a very interesting thing. There is a very interesting thing, which is that if I take all the spins up, I ignore all the negative spins right now. I take all the spins up, and then I draw a line between, from the up spin, I draw a line to, let me draw that a green line. I draw a line to the nearest neighbor. So I pick up only the up spins, and from the up spins, I draw a line to the nearest neighbor, because I have only nearest neighbor interactions. Now this is something very nice. So if my these spins is also up, then I draw one from this, then I draw another from this. So in this case, what you will have, a double line between, I will have a double line between 2 up spins. But if it is a down spin, then I will have one line. So to begin with, let me summarize. I pick only the up spins, and from the up spins I draw a line to the nearest neighbor. How many lines I will have? I have gamma nearest neighbors, and from each up spins I am drawing to the next one. So then I will have gamma n plus. That is the total number of lines that I will draw. What then will be equal to? Here will be n plus plus will come with 2. So this is the conservation condition that must be obeyed. So in order to show n equal to n plus plus n minus, which is the conservation condition, I get a second conservation condition. Now I say, okay, I want to do the same thing now, starting only with the down spins. Again I get this relation.
So, what do I get now?
I get 3 relations. So, I started with 5 variables, and now I 5 variables that comes into the that enters the Hamiltonian, but now I find that those 5 variables are not independent, they have 3 relations between them. So, I now have the essentially 2 independent variables. Now, that now tells me, okay, if I have a choice that I can have 2 independent variables. So, what are the 2 independent variables I choose? Can you make a guess? One of them I will make either n plus or n minus, but only one of them is possible. So, I take n plus, other I take n plus plus. So, these are now my independent variables. Everything else now has to be. So, I have to now express n plus and n plus and n plus plus in terms of all other things. So, I can eliminate, I will eliminate all those other variables and I will get I'll express n plus minus, n minus minus and n minus in terms of capital N, my total number of spins and these 2. So, once I can do that, I can now write the Hamiltonian in terms of only these 2 variables. Still everything, still now everything is exact. Everything is exact. Okay. So, we will go very far by being exact, then we will make a very significant contribution, and that is the significant assumption which is the reason that I want to do this mean field approximation in a very robust and systematic way, because this is the something with majority of the students will at some stage will just like Landau theory will use day in and day out. And similarly, this is a very general way of doing things which finds lot of applications and in the future research. Okay. So, now we now need to bear with me for a minute. Now, we have the relations and we now need to eliminate and get a so we have done that. Now, now I do go back to Hamiltonian. This is a large number of steps involved. This even the mean field theory calculation is fairly non-trivial. Any Landau type theory is highly intuitive and not technically non-trivial. Van der Waals is, you know, not non-trivial, but those do not have the details of the interactions. When you want to build in the details of intermolecular interactions, like here we are doing spin-spin interactions, and you have already have the experience of Mayer's theory, which was of course not mean field, things are not easy. So, one has to do I remember one class I was taking at Brown, and is to have a small story to tell you that, and we had the great Leo Kadanoff was teaching statistical mechanics. I was fortunate to have his class twice, now one at Brown and one in Chicago. Now, Leo Kadanoff was doing gave these very difficult problems and in his course, and so there was this postdoc or a student, I do not remember, from Nobel laureate Leon Cooper, and who was you know pretty good. And then so one day Kadanoff asked, so what is your opinion and what is about your instruments in general, how the course going, how do you find it? That is the way actually people go. They always ask you at some stage that how are the things going. And this student, whose name I forgot, then told Leo Kadanoff that is all is great and nice, but your problems are not elegant. Your problems are too laborious and too elaborate and boring. So it is not elegant. So Leo Karanov got very upset. Then Leo Karanov went on saying, give a long lecture. And the summary of that was is the following. He said that look, in physics, it is 90% of the time or 95% of the time you are just doing the hard work and you have no chance of being elegant. You are very lucky 5% of the time you get to be elegant. So better you know that doing theoretical physics or any theoretical science is a huge amount is hard work, but you do that hard work because you like this kind of a work, but do not expect that you will get the chance of being elegant. So we will see now a large number of steps that we will do and we will go back and forth. And so to make it easy for the students, I will give you a flow chart and go through the flow chart and then do the this is the way. I hope you can read, but I will read it for you. If not, because it is not I do not think it is very big, but this will be passed on to you. There are certain problems on the right side that would be then corrected in the notes that will be handed over with the course. That means what we will do, you will be able to read it here anyway, but you will be seeing that the final thing will more complete. So we consider lattice of n spins. We consider lattice of n spins, as I said, only nearest number interactions. Write down Ising spin Hamiltonian H. So this H I write down in terms of sigma I sigma j minus j minus b sigma I. Okay. Now if I write down, then this is the following thing: j sigma I sigma j gives me. So sigma I sigma j with nearest neighbor, I get the following results. Please check it out: n plus 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 n minus 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 n plus minus. Okay. Now I can do sigma I, this time I can do sigma I, and sigma I get n plus minus n minus, right? That because plus comes, plus spins comes with plus 1, up spins, top spins come with plus 1, the those pointing towards the up, they get plus 1, those are 9 minus 1. So that is this thing, this is this thing, and then sigma I sigma j is then plus minus. So when they are both are plus, say both are minus, as I said so before. So then you see these 5 variables are coming, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 5 variables come just from the Hamiltonian. We are not introducing them just like that, it is a necessity of the calculation. Every step that I am going to do is very logical and they go from one step to another step and very systematic. And the beauty of this thing that I am doing, why I am not doing the 2D Ising model and doing this thing, is because this gives you, you know, piece by piece, minute by minute, more value for your time than the other thing. Now, then there are these 5 natural variables come. Note that they are obtained by picking a, so there is a relation, there are 3 relations, as I said, between, and we have done that between them. They are obtained by picking first only the up spins, and in the up spins then you write down that what are the ups, the for the up spins, and the condition we remember gamma I n plus equal to 2 n plus 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 n plus minus, then gamma n minus equal to 2 n minus minus plus n plus minus, and of course we have the other condition n is n plus plus n minus. Okay. That we have only 2 independent variables and we choose, as I said, n and n plus 1. Okay. Now we continue with these things. This is amazing. Suddenly we see that things have become very simple. We can express the Ising Hamiltonian in terms of these 2 variables only, and they gives so all these proportional to n plus and n minus. Up to this point everything is exact, Now we will go on till now for quite some time, which will be exact. So now I go back to partition function, sum over all possible values of n plus and n double plus, and then I write the Hamiltonian now in terms of n plus and n plus plus. Well, I have not written down for you what would be that, I will do in a minute, what will be the real Hamiltonian in terms of n plus and n plus and plus plus, that I will do in a minute because I have to eliminate those things which are little time consuming. Okay. We have as I said, we have done everything exactly, and now after that one does a shortcut with the mean field theory. Okay. Now before I go to mean field theory, I just want to draw this thing that the why I need the mean field theory. Okay. So at this point with this Hamilton, it turns out with this everything is exact up to this point, and here we get stuck because we cannot evaluate the partition function with n plus n plus plus. This is the main problem of two dimensional model, three dimensional everywhere, but this is where we will be able to make an approximation, very enlightened approximation. So now I am going to go and do a little bit more calculations and go a little bit further and let you know. So I have now used this, I have to have these three relations, we now know. So I can now show by using these three relation is this you can verify. Everything in terms of now, only in terms of n plus plus n plus n plus plus, and sigma ij is now and sigma I okay. This is all right. So I have, this is the one trivial, this one I get by substituting into n plus plus, then I have n minus 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 n plus minus, that is this thing. Then I eliminate n minus minus and n plus minus in terms of n plus and n double plus. When I do that, then I get this equation. You can just a trivial exercise, you can all of you can do that, and then this one. So now, and I have J in front, so I now have the Hamiltonian in terms of n plus. So I now go, I said okay, I have the Hamiltonian H as a function of n plus and n plus plus. I have the Hamiltonian. So now what I need to do, then I need to do, I have to write the partition function of Ising as a function of T, temperature, total number of spins N, and magnetic field B. What do I need to do? I need to do G this H. If I can do that, I am all set. I can express H in terms of n plus, but I cannot evaluate this quantity. This is now the final barrier that we faced. Till now everything done exactly, but we cannot do that. Okay. So we are stuck. So let me write down, I have already written down the Hamiltonian, but by combining those things, still I can combine once I can give you once more the total Hamiltonian H equal to same, I am doing minus 4J N plus 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 2 gamma J minus B in plus minus half comma j minus b n. So this is the Hamiltonian. So the e to the power minus beta h that has to go, this h goes there, but in front this part is okay. But I need to evaluate g. If I could evaluate the number of ways I can find out n plus, I give you n and n plus, and if you can give me number of ways you can realize that configuration with the given n plus n plus minus 1, then if I can give you an expression, then I will be able to play the trick that maximize the partition function and minimize the free energy and pick up the term, but I do not have any clue to that. Now how do you do that? Now I will go one step backward and I will do something really very, very interesting. So now I introduce two terms. One is called long range order parameter, L, and the short range order parameter. Yes. Now I introduce, remember L long range and S, I'll change the notation little bit, I'll again call it sigma but without a subscript. So short range error parameter sigma for S, this is the universal notation. So I am going in many books, in order to separate, they say sigma, instead of sigma I sigma j for the up and plus 1 and minus 1 values of the spin up and down, they use Si and Sj, but sigma I and sigma j is the more common thing, and short range order parameter sigma is also fairly common. But since we do not have any superscript to sigma, we will have no problem. That means short range and long range order, L for long range, sigma for short range, just easy to remember. So now I define the following way, definitions, very nice definitions. The fraction of up spins and double spins . So L, clearly you can see L is less than 1, greater than minus 1, sigma is less than 1, greater than minus 1. So when L is 1, when L is 1, then this is 1 plus 1, 2, and these 2 gets it 1, that means all these spins are up. So when L long range order parameter is 1, means all these spins are up, system is fully ferromagnetic. Short range on the other hand is the following way, again sigma is 1, is 1, and this is half gamma n, gamma n is the gamma is the number of nearest neighbors. So you, in order to avoid double counting, you put the half in front of it, because you are n plus plus, you can count this one and this one twice, so half gamma n for that. Now sigma is 1. When sigma is 1, then it becomes 1, that means n plus plus becomes equal to half gamma n. And then on the other hand, if that means all the short range, all the short range parameters are up, all the nearest neighbors are up, and on the other hand when it is minus 1, then it is 0, then you do not have any all up spins, everything is surrounding your nearest neighbors, all spins are down. Okay. So these are the definitions of the short range and long range, this is long range. Now they look at this long range order parameter, it is very, very intuitive and very interesting. This is nothing but, as I told you, total number of spins, is, this is nothing but when all these spins are up, I know n plus, I know n, then I know n minus, and n plus minus n minus is nothing but the magnetization m. You have, that is the magnetization. So If I know n plus, I have the magnetization, the problem that I want to solve. N plus plus on the other hand is a microscopic quantity, and I do not have any handle on that, except I know when many many spins are up, then I have when there is a ferromagnetic state, not all spins are up. You know, to be a ferromagnetic state, all you have to do, n plus is greater than n minus, okay. And you want that ferromagnetic state to be established, or a significant number of spin greater than, by a phase transition. That means it has to jump from low magnetic state to high magnetic state. That happens at certain temperature. So it is the essential part of change of magnetization m in a singular way. Now I want to capture that part, but I don't have, as I said, much of a handle of n plus plus, except that in when the magnetic state, then more n plus plus would be more than n plus minus and more than n minus minus, okay, because there are more spins that will be up. Other than that, I don't have any handle on that. And of course, I know if the ferromagnetic interactions low temperature, there are more of that. So this is the situation that we are now dealt with. So we have done till now all the things correctly, but now we are going to towards something physical inside, because we have gone as far as we can exactly by decomposing into n plus and n plus plus, eliminating other three variables. Everything is exact. Gamma changes in two dimension, triangular lattice is 6, square lattice is 4. Then your three dimensional lattice, square cubic lattice is 6, BCC is 8, and FCC is RHCP are 12. So you know that. And so the only thing that is taking care, because of the nearest neighbor interactions, is gamma. I am tuning gamma, I am changing the, I am capturing the powers of the system. But we have gone as far as we can, because we cannot evaluate the number of state Gn plus and n plus plus. So now long range and short range order parameter have two physical things. Can you work with that? And that is what mean field theory does. They work with these two. So now I want to express the next following thing. I can now go, since n plus and n plus minus are again in terms of, so L is in terms of n plus, n plus plus. That immediately tells you, now I will be able to write the Hamiltonian in terms of L and sigma. So instead of a microscopic kind of thing, well, this is not microscopic, this is microscopic, I am going to go into a order parameter, and then I can hope to make an assumption and an approximation, okay. So let me write down the Hamiltonian in terms of L and it. So I can write this thing like that, sigma I is very easy to say, it is NL, right, because N plus is N plus by N and now I can also write, I can show that this you can do, because we have done sigma I, sigma j before, a few slides before we have evaluated that. Now I just put the definition of L and sigma, and I get the following thing. I am just writing it down. So I can now write the Hamiltonian. So I write the Hamiltonian H in terms of L and sigma. Now what do I do? So what I do now is make an ansatz. So I have expressed Hamiltonian, I have expressed H in terms of L and sigma. So So I have introduced two qualitatively nice things, but I have really not made any significant progress other than that. So, but now I look one thing. Now I am going to make an approximation. Now I say the following things. I go back to probability and I say, okay, my probability of having two spins up, two consecutive spins up next to each other in nearest neighbor. If I now assume that this probability that it is up is they are independent of each other. So they are multiplication of the being up, then probability of pn plus plus, so the fraction of n plus plus would be same as n plus minus n square. So I now make the approximation, the fraction of n plus plus of the possible thing is, so this is my ansatz, this is my mean field approximation. That means there is no short range order other than what is contained in long range order. So this is the essence of mean field approximation, that you ignore the short range correlations and you say short range correlation is given by the long range correlation. So once I make this approximation, what do I achieve after this approximation? So what do I achieve? I have now eliminated. So once I do that, I already have an a in terms of L sigma or n plus plus. I went to L and sigma to get the physical essence, long range and short range order, and I say short range order is those same that flows from long range order. Probabilistically I can argue that n plus plus is given by n plus. So I then eliminated from by one logic one more variable. So I have eliminated the n plus plus by giving that condition. And once I eliminated n plus plus, what I do? I go back, I already have h in terms of n plus and n plus plus, and I get that now h in terms of n plus only. I have the Hamiltonian in terms of these two, now I have in terms of that. Then what do I gain after making the approximation? Now if I have this Hamiltonian in plus, my Ising model partition function, my partition function of Ising for any dimension, for any dimension D, sum over all pos n plus, that can be from 0 to n, number of states I can distribute n out of n spins, and now how many ways I can get n plus out of n, beta h n plus. I now, so what is the whole crux of the thing is this reduction, and once I can do that I can write and this is approximate, of course this is approximate, is an answer, but I can now write this. But lo and behold, I know that that is nothing but n factorial by n and I know this quantity. So now I can go from the sum under the summation, I can find out the maximum term method. So at the end of this long road, we are in a position now to exactly evaluate the partition function, exactly evaluate the free energy. And we will take a short break now and we will come and do that by following the most elegant description that I know of this problem, that is Carson Huang. But basically what I said, I will probably in a faster pace evaluate that and take you through the results. Okay.